Today is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Good morning and welcome to our worship on this, the second Sunday after Christmas, and Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year.
You made it to 2022. Congratulations. We have just a handful of announcements for you this morning. First and foremost, we keep in our prayers your Gladys, Charlie, Barbara, and we add to our prayer list this morning Heidi Kingston, who's a friend of Alyssa Pry. She suffered a stroke last week and has a hole in her heart that they are repairing. So please keep her in your prayers. She's in her early 30s. That's kind of an odd age to have a stroke. So by all means, pray for her. The second announcement for this morning is that this being the second Sunday of Christmas, this week begins the Epiphany season on Thursday, followed by the baptism of our Lord. So today, the Christmas decorations are coming down, and if you have a mind and a heart to help with taking down these Christmas decorations, I know it would be appreciated. And then finally, the prayer sisters meet on the first and third Monday of the month, and tomorrow is the first Monday of the month. And that starts at 2:30 at 1049 Ringwood Avenue, apartment 210 in Haskell. If you have any questions, please talk to Linda Potavin. That said, please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Please kneel.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
The first reading is from the third chapter of 1 Kings.
The king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. Solomon used to offer 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night. And God said, "Ask what I shall give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him his great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne this day. And now, O Lord, my God, you have made your servant king in place of David, my father. Although I am but a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of your people whom you have chosen, a great people, too many to be numbered or counted for multitude. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this, your great people?" It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. And God said to him, "Because you have asked this, and have not asked for yourself long life or riches, or the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, behold, I now do according to your word. Behold, I give you a wise and discerning mind, so that none like you has been before you, and none like you shall arise after you. I give you also what you have not asked, both riches and honor, so that no other king shall compare with you all your days. And if you walk in my ways, keeping my statutes and my commandments, as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your days." And Solomon awoke, and behold, it was a dream. Then he came to Jerusalem and stood before the ark of the covenant of the Lord, and offered up burnt offerings and peace offerings, and made a feast for all his servants. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's appointed psalm is number 119. We sing verses 97 through 104.
Thank you.
filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. Now every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover, and when he was 12 years old, they went up as usual for the festival. When the festival was ended and they started to return, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but his parents did not know it. Assuming that he was in the group of travelers, they went a day's journey. Then they started to look for him among their relatives and friends. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem to search for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw them, they were astonished, and his mother said to him, "Child, why have you treated us like this? Look, your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety." He said to them, "Why were you searching for me? Did you not know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he said to them. Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. His mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and in years, in divine and human favor. This is the gospel of the Lord. Grace, peace, and mercy be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text for this morning's meditation on this, the second Sunday of Christmas, is found in our gospel lesson, Luke chapter 2, verses 40 to 52. When Jesus was 8 days old, his parents presented him at the temple to do for him according to the custom of the law. And after that event, Luke stated, "And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him." However, the only incident recorded in the Gospels about the early life of Jesus is this account from our Gospel lesson, with Jesus in the temple when he was 12 years old. Now, in the early centuries of the church, much as with today, there was a great interest in the early life of Jesus. I have personally fielded many questions from people who were curious about who this young Jesus was. What was it like to be the God-boy? Did Mary look at Jesus' brothers and sisters and say, "Why can't you be more like the Savior?" Did Jesus have friends? When did Jesus start using his divine powers? It feels very much like all of this is vain speculation, and yet it was on the minds of people long ago, as well as today. One author used his imagination and attempted to fill in the hidden years of Jesus' life before his ministry. He called it the Gospel of Thomas. In this text, amongst other things, the author imagined a young Jesus burgeoning with divine powers in his infancy and prepubescent years. Examples of this fantasy story put on display the author's intention. Jesus molded 12 mud sparrows after being scolded for profaning the Sabbath. He clapped his hands, and the sparrows became real and flew away. Young Jesus caused a child who was mean to him and picking on him to drop dead. And yet, in another instant, he dropped down from a third-story rooftop to the ground and restored life to another youth who had fallen from it. Young Jesus reaped 100 bushels of wheat from a single kernel. He also stretched out to length a bed which Joseph had foolishly made too short. And the author's intention with this fantastic writing? Well, the author described Jesus as an arrogant wonder boy, a little super savior who used his powers selfishly. And that sounds more like you and me than it does the promised Messiah from long ago. Now, in contrast to the imaginative writing of that author, there is recorded this single event in Luke from the real life of the young Jesus. Now, this is even told with restraint, and it avoided the notion that Jesus could do better anything than anyone else, simply by playing that divine power card. Luke believed this story from Jesus' youth would be a benefit in explaining Jesus, and thus we learn something from Jesus' younger years by this story's conclusion. Now, you might wonder how Luke came across this story. When you read the opening of Luke's Gospel, you might discover that Mary was his primary source. That lineage that Luke gave us in the very beginning of the Gospel was all Mary's family tree. And as you read, especially in our Gospel lesson today, you find references to Jesus' parents. And that reference is Joseph and his mother. And the incident closes with words that could only have come from Mary. And his mother kept all these things in her heart. She remembered the things that were revealed to her before Jesus was even born, and she wondered how these things fit into those prophecies. Now, of course, being good parents, Joseph and Mary took Jesus with them to the temple to celebrate all the events of the year. The occasion of this account was the Feast of the Passover. Now, according to Jewish ceremonial law, all males were required to appear in Jerusalem for 3 festivals every year. The law's direction was, 3 times a year all your males shall appear before the Lord your God at the place which he will choose, and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, Passover, at the Feast of Weeks, and at the Feast of Booths. Women were not required to make those pilgrimages, but they often did. And the Jewish tradition was that even boys in their tender years were required to put in an appearance at the temple during this time. Now, at this particular festival, the company from Nazareth set out from home, and it must have been a fairly large group, since the absence of Jesus was not immediately noticed. But when he was missed, his parents quickly returned to the city to find him there in the temple. And what was it that Jesus was doing? He was sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. And the aforementioned author of the Gospel of Thomas might have assumed that Jesus was standing there above the teachers and lecturing them. But Jesus' actual manner of teaching was to listen. It was to ask questions. It was to answer questions. And those who witnessed it were astounded by Jesus' insight and understanding. And why should they not be astounded? Wouldn't you be astounded to have a 12-year-old stand in front of you and tell you things about your faith that you never even imagined? Tell you things about Holy Scripture that had never even entered into your head? What would you feel to have God sitting at your feet, learning, or to be more exact, to have Jesus sitting at your feet, teaching? This is a little glimpse into the process of Jesus growing into the fullness of God incarnate. Now, when Joseph and Mary found Jesus in the temple and they expressed their anxiety, how did Jesus answer them? He said, "Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" If you were to translate this woodenly from the Greek, Jesus would have said, "I must be doing the things of my Father." That could mean going about my Father's business. That could mean being in my Father's house. But whatever the precise meaning was, Jesus, in his first words of record, referred to God as Father. His Father. It is a little wonder that Mary kept all these things in her heart. The angel Gabriel announced to Mary that her child would be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And you know, the crazy thing is that the truth of God being Father to Jesus extends to you and me as well. We are born so late into the time of God's kingdom, yet now we are sons and daughters of God through the suffering and death and resurrection of God's firstborn Son. Our adoption into God's family was all made possible by the work of Jesus, and it became a reality for us in our baptism. Paul taught it most directly in his letter to the Galatians. "For in Christ Jesus you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ." Now, the standard of baptism may have little impact on the casual observer, but every baptism is of great and eternal significance because the promise of God attends every baptism. Don't let that statement pass you by. God is present in every baptism. The promise of God attended your baptisms. And God, because of Jesus, will always claim us as his children. And as our Father, God sees to our welfare. He has already secured for us our spiritual welfare in granting us forgiveness and in providing us eternal life in heaven. As Jesus stated, "In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you that I go to prepare a place for you." This event in the temple with Jesus naming God as his Father has grand implications. implications for us who also call God Father. Now see, as previously stated, Jesus' exact reply to his parents' burgeoning anxiety was, "I must be about the things of my Father." The things or the business of his Father was nothing less than learning, nothing less than discussing the scripture in the temple of Jerusalem. And after this event in the temple, Luke asserted that Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. And from here, Luke viewed Christ's entire ministry so far as to describe his crucifixion. And he did this because he knew that the outcome of Jesus' work among men was not defeat. The outcome was victory. Resurrection triumphed over death. And that tremendous fact gives meaning to everything that Jesus did. And the business of the Father embraced all things that went into the redemption of the world. And of this business, Jesus said, "I must be about them." And throughout the ministry of Jesus, there runs this idea of necessity. The idea of must is the necessity which compelled Jesus to heal the man born blind. Jesus said, "We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work." And the greatest necessity from the Father that Jesus assumed was giving himself on the cross. He told his disciples, "The Son of God must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised." These things were necessary. These things must happen. And they did. The necessity of Jesus being about his Father's business becomes our own necessity. Paul spoke of this necessity that was laid upon him, for the love of Christ controls us. It is not a necessity produced by a legal obligation to God, but rather one that flows from a heart motivated by the very love of God in Christ. And it is important to understand that as sons and daughters of the Father, we're not moved to take on the Father's business just because we're moral, just because we're pious people. Our motivation and our ability comes from the same grace that made us God's children in the first place. What then is the business of the Father that becomes our necessity? It is nothing less than carrying out and carrying on the ministry of Jesus. It is nothing less than loving, nothing less than helping, nothing less than giving, nothing less than teaching, nothing less than praying. Nothing less than witnessing. These things are the will of God for our lives. These things have become our will and our work through faith in Jesus Christ. In his name, amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the Church of God, that God would preserve her faithful, and for her ministers, that God would give them delight in this joyful season and restful reflection on the mystery of the incarnation that they preach. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Christian homes, that following the example of our Lord Jesus, all children would be diligent to hear the word of God, grow in wisdom and stature, submit to earthly parents, and always be about the Heavenly Father's business and in his house. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Joseph, our president, for all public servants, for the government and those who protect us, that they may be upheld and strengthened in every good deed. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick and everyone in any kind of need, for Gladys, Bjorn, Charlie, Claire, Barbara, Heidi, and for all that we name now in our hearts. For patience and healing according to God's gracious will. In thanksgiving for every blessing and kindness shown to us in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who come to be blessed by the sacrament this day, that as Christ once won our redemption through his body and blood, so now, according to the riches of his grace, he would grant us worthy repentance, confident faith, and unity in a sincere confession. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, in mercy you have established the Christian home among us. We implore you, rule and direct our hearts to be good examples to children and those subject to us, that we may not offend them by word or deed, but faithfully teach them to love your church and hear your blessed word. Give them your spirit and grace, that this seed may bring forth good fruit and our home life may advance your glory, honor and praise, as well as our own improvement and welfare, giving offense to no one. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the same Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Thank you.
should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have given us a new revelation of your glory, that seeing you in the person of your Son, we may know and love your glory and those things that are not seen. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Thank you. forgiveness of all of your sins. Amen.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you steadfast in true faith to life everlasting. Depart now in his peace. Amen. Amen. Receive now the benediction of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. Amen. Amen.